The views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
This program is brought to you in part with the generous support from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs and the New York State Council on the Arts.
Welcome to Bronx Film Wednesdays. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez. Bronx Film Wednesdays is presented by Pregones Puerto Rican Traveling Theater and BronxNet. We bring independent films and short films that you will love from our 21 Islands International Short Film Festival. Travel the world and open your mind to stories as far as the imagination can go. This month, we are celebrating Latin American cinema, presenting short films from the Dominican Republic, Cuba, Puerto Rico, Brazil, and Argentina. We will also have an interview with Michelle Malley-Campos, the director of a short called In Pieces, or In Pedazos, a film that presents topics like addiction, mental health, love, and compassion. So stay tuned. For now, we present our first shorts from Puerto Rico, We Are Going to Paris, and from Cuba, El Zurdo. Let's watch.
Rosita, vamos a ir al aeropuerto a llevar a tu tía, que se va de luna de miel para París.
Como la abuela.
Como la abuela.
¿Y nosotros?
No, mi amor, nosotros no tenemos dinero para ir para París. La ciudad más hermosa del mundo.
Maldita sea.
¡Rosita!
Rosita.
Tranquilo, Gonzalo. Esto lo hemos ensayado mil veces. Mira, yo entro aquí, por aquí, y me paro aquí en la fila, que es por aquí, espérate. Entonces, yo entro y me paro en la fila y tú entras.
¿Y tú no crees que debe ser mejor entrar primero, ver el lugar por dentro?
Ay, Gonzalo, maldita sea. Yo trabajé en ese banco 30 años. Me lo conozco de la A a la Z. Oye, ¿Benito será todavía el gerente?
Rosita, tú trabajaste 30 años, hace como 30 años. Y Benítez debe haberse muerto hace 15. Además, esto es una locura. ¿Mejor que?
¿Mejor que qué? Que dejemos que el banco nos quite la casa. Esa casita que nos jodimos tanto para construirla. Y que quedemos en la calle. No, dame acá.
Mejor tranquila, mi amor, tranquila.
Pero lo vas a hacer, ¿lo vas a hacer o no lo vas a hacer?
¿Por qué no lo hacemos al revés? ¿Veniste?
Que no oye ni ve.
Hola, bienvenido al Hogar Larga Vida. Disculpen los inconvenientes, ¿verdad? Porque nos acabamos de mudar y no hemos podido sacar los letreros del banco que cerró hace como 30 años. ¿Usted viene solo o con familia?
¿Hogar larga qué?
¿Larga vida?
Espérese un momentito, por favor.
¡Al suelo! ¡Todo el mundo al suelo, dije! ¡Todo el mundo! ¡Me toques!
¡Rosita!
¡Quiero el dinero!
¡Rosita!
¡Quiero
mi,
todo el dinero! ¡Todo mi, en una bolsa!
¡Mi vida,
más,
Rosita!
¡No me toques! ¿Pero
Rosita,
qué
por
haces?
Favor. Disculpen todos ustedes. Esta es mi adorada esposa, Rosita, que está un poquito senil, bastante senil. Y para eso hemos venido a este maravilloso hogar Buena Vida.
Larga vida.
Pero sí, larga, larga, porque mi amada esposa, Rosita, necesita ayuda. Últimamente le ha dado con eso. La semana pasada le dio con que quería secuestrar un avión. ¿Pero qué es esto? ¿2,000 pesos mensuales por persona? Esto sí que es un robo.
Oiga, ¿usted está seguro que esto es de juguete? Porque es que esto se ve real.
Sí, sí, sí. Tenga mucho cuidado, que es un juguete muy costoso. Se la compré para que jugara cuando le dio con lo de los robos.
Ya.
No.
Ya.
No, no.
Ya.
¿Un dibujo?
Sí. Como si hubieras estado en la torre.
Sí, lo entendí perfectamente.
¿Te gusta?
¿Eso es todo?
No, no te gusta.
¿Los pasajes a París?
Yo te prometo
que... Tú me prometiste que me ibas a llevar de luna de miel a París, pero como lo que haces es gastar los chavos en la porquería de carro esa...
Rosita, mi amor, yo te juro que...
¿Senila?
Yo dije un poquito senil.
Sí, pero después dijiste bastante senil.
Mi amor, pudiéramos estar presos ahora mismo si yo no...
Está bien, sí, es verdad. Está bien, mi vida. Mire que un asilo de anciano en el banco. Y qué viejo se veía Benítez, ¿verdad?
Debe tener como 115 años. Oye, pero ¿por qué tú te paras aquí en el pueblo? ¿Tú vas a comprar algo?
Chacho, con esta pelambrera que yo tengo, ¿cómo voy a comprar algo? Eso es, mira...
Ay, Rosita, tú no aprendes, ¿ah? ¿Eh? ¿O vas a empezar a ponerte senil?
Ay, Gonzalo, tú es más zángano. Mira, piénsalo bien. Después del atraco, nos vamos a la casita con tu carrito. Y a ver si por fin organizamos los planes de irnos a la luna de miel esa que tú me quieres dar en París. Si no, vamos a terminar en la calle, como Dios nos trajo al mundo.
Tú sabes que yo jamás voy a permitir eso. Como tampoco voy a permitir que una cárcel nos separe.
¡Ay, qué lindo! A mí esa máscara me puso como una fiera. De verdad, me convirtió como en otra cosa. Ay, ¿qué es eso?
¡Arranca, puñeta! ¡Arranca!
¿Sabes lo que hago?
¡Arranca, puñeta! ¡Dale, doñita! ¡Dale, muévete! ¡Mira, ey! ¡Ey, ey, viejo! ¡No me mires! ¡Mira, no me mires o te mato, ¿sabes? Y doña, dale más rápido, por favor, ¿ah? Mira, que si no, les quito esta porquería de carro, ¿ah? Y los dejo por ahí tirados. El nudo lo puedo dejar por ahí tirado, como Dios lo trajo a este mundo. Mira que yo no como el cuento, ¿ah? Este carro no tiene cinturón, mano. Va a salir por ahí volado. ¡Soy rico, puñeta! ¡Diablo! Doña, llega para el aeropuerto mejor. Dale, dale, para el aeropuerto. Sí, sí, sí.
¡Ok, pendejito! ¡Dame esa pistola ahora mismo, coño!
Toma.
¡Me siento como una fiera!
Thank you. adelante. A la izquierda. A la derecha. Paso de péndulo. Perfecto. Desplazamiento. Ahí. Dando ya ahí. De allá. De la derecha. Perfecto. Espera un momento. Fíjate lo que te voy a decir. Ha avanzado mucho. No quiero enterarme que tú andas por la calle tirando trompadas por ahí. ¿Bien? El boxeo es para competir.
Arriba, sombra.
Profe, dos penas más allá.
Dos penas y dos, compadre. Usted está sancionado, compadre. La cagaste, la cagaste. Mira, el otro día vino tu abuelo. Dice que está trabajando en un bar. ¿Qué pasa eso? Ayúdalo. Es más, cuando vayas a verlo, Independencia, lo que diga, tú vienes aquí y me dices, si él quiere que te entrene, o algo.
No va a entender nada de eso.
Oye, me
va a
meter en banca. Te estoy dando la posibilidad de que corrija lo que hiciste, mi hermano.
Sí.
¿Eh? Sí. Si no, si no, cumple la sanción y te vas para tu casa, ¿viste? ¡Copiate! ¡Copiate!
Voy, voy.
Arriba, vamos.
I can put it on. chico,
¿Dónde está el dinero?
¿Qué dinero tú me estás hablando, chico, eh? ¿Qué? ¡Ya!
¿Dónde está? ¿Dónde está lo que falta?
¿Qué falta? Yo no tengo nada, tú.
Ya, oye, ya está bueno, ya, yo no tengo nada.
¡Ay, ya! ¡Ya no me dé más, cojones! ¡No me dé más! ¡Ya! ¡Eso eran dos partes! Yo nada más que tenía esa sola parte. Yo no sé dónde está.
Me hace falta que damos unos días aquí. ¿Puedo hacerlo o no?
Yo no puedo ver bronca, no puedo ver nada. Esa junta de dos, pues.
¿Tú puedes hacer? ¿La junta de dos qué? ¿Esa junta de dos a ellos? ¿Te puedes solo hacer?
Mira, a ver.
¿Algo jamás?
Sí, así siempre hay para los amigos, hay de todo.
Ya,
ahí. Ahí lo que
¿vas a hablar eso?
No. Déjame echarme mi traído todavía, que esto es la amanezco, ¿eh?
Estamos cerrados.
Thank you.
Oye.
Creo que en esquina San Francisco, en la calle San Francisco, ¿no? En el número 67. Salto, oye, ¿ustedes se demoran mucho? Ah, ya, ya, ok, ok. Bueno, muchas gracias.
Toma una cerveza ahí donde puedan. ¿Tú sabes si el bar este de aquí al frente abrió hoy?
Hoy hubo un bateo hoy. Parece que el puro que pincha ahí se buscó tremenda tanga. Es un caño.
This was the first place I worked when I moved to New York City as a young artist. One of the only places in New York where I can explore my artistic side and my culture. And it's a place where both of those things can come together.
Also in the sense of community with front of house and just everybody involved in the Bregones family makes people feel happy and makes people leave the theater feeling lifted.
Welcome back to Bronx Film Wednesdays. Now we present from Brazil, Adito, and from Dominican Republic, Cardumen. Let's watch.
Paciência, Ruby. Eu não posso deixar você adormecer. Não vai dizer nada? Você falava tanto do cheiro do mar. Do vento. Thank you.
Era estranho. Eu voltava pelo mesmo caminho de onde vim, na escuridão. E o sonho simplesmente acabava.
Se o sonho fosse meu, teria permanecido no quarto. Morro de medo no escuro. Acho que deveríamos fazer um filme com seu sonho.
Dime, ¿qué yo te he dicho?
Yo te va a robar.
¿Qué yo te... No se metan en esta vaina, coño. ¿Qué yo te dije que te iba a hacer?
Yo te va a robar.
¿Qué yo te dije que te iba a hacer?
Cardumen es un hermoso banco de peces similares que nadan sincronizados para defenderse de los depredadores más grandes. Los peces usan muchas tricuñuelas para elegir compañeros de cardumen. Tamaño del cardumen, tipo de especies, tamaño corporal, salud de los miembros del cardumen y afinidad o parentesco.
Joselito, Joselito, papi.
No le encuentro.
Hablamos ahora.
¿Dónde vas?
No se preocupe. Yo vengo ahora.
Dios mío. Joselito, ven a bañarte, que se ve el agua.
Joselito, Joselito, papi.
¿Cómo te va la pesca?
Mal, mal, no he pescado nada hoy. Está mala la pesca.
¿Está muy sucia,
río? Sí, está sucio. Doy un chin de papel y un poquito de tape. Oh.
Mira, tú me le vas a llevar eso a Ramona. Me le dice que a la otra parte yo se la entrego mañana. Ay, le dice a mamá que yo estoy por allá como eso a las dos. Oíste.
Papi, yo puedo buscar un minuto de cuando
termine. Sí, está bien.
¿De verdad, papi?
Sí.
Oíste, eso no se va a quedar así, oíste. Yo te voy a mandar a la policía a ti. Yo voy a averiguar dónde tú vives, oíste.
¿Y qué fue, manito?
Manito, mira, no hagas caso a lo que está diciendo ese tipo que está ahí, oíste. Tipo medio tratado. ¿Y tú por dónde vas?
Ay, lleva unos cuartos
para. No, mira. Yo necesito que nos vayamos para la casa ahora mismo, que tú no salgas. Yo ando con papi de los cuartos. Así que vamos, oíste, confía en mí, ven, vamos.
¿Y tú qué quieres?
Yo vine a ver si tú me puedes devolver mi Game Boy.
Yo llegué como hasta el 10 en el memory card.
¿Te lo voy a vender?
Creo que yo no tengo guarda.
¿Y ese cancillo?
Por ahí no, casi no hay nada.
Pero eso no importa.
¿Por qué tú me lo quieres vender?
Yo la mantengo 100 pesos.
Emprétame lo que yo te lo voy a poner después.
¿Y el caqui?
Por favor, emprétame.
Qué raro, porque tú no estás jugando tazo.
Es lo como ustedes creen, ¿no? Oye, yo quiero verlo. Yo quiero saber dónde ustedes viven para hablar con él.
¿Qué yo te he dicho? Dime, ¿qué yo te he dicho? ¿Eh? ¿Qué yo te he dicho? Yo te dije que cuando lo volviera a hacer, ¿qué te iba a hacer? ¡No se metan en esta vaina, coño! ¿Qué te iba a hacer?
¡Yo te va robando!
Dime, ¿qué te he dicho? Dime, 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 sí, dime.
El etólogo animal Stephen G. Reeves, escribiendo el Journal Animal Behavior, argumenta que los cardúmenes son liderados por un pequeño número de más experimentados individuos.
This was the first place I worked when I moved to New York City as a young artist. One of the only places in New York where I can explore my artistic side and my culture. And it's a place where both of those things can come together.
Also in the sense of community with front of house and just everybody involved in the Bregones family makes people feel happy and makes people leave the theater feeling lifted.
Welcome back to Bronx Film Wednesdays. Now we present our last two shorts from Argentina, Luminares, and from Puerto Rico, In Pieces, directed by Michelle Malley-Campos, with whom we will have an interview later on. So stay tuned. Let's watch.
Thank you. ¡Hermanote!
Carajo. Vamos. Vámonos. Vámonos.
No son mucho.
¿Oye?
¿Qué viejo te ve?
You don't look so good, Norm.
¿Cómo te pusiste tan viejo?
Trabajando. Doing something with my life past 10 years. ¿Qué coño tú has estado haciendo?
Amiga, you're being mean.
You're acting like a lowlife. I mean, what the hell? O sea, yo regreso para acá y tengo que sacarte un lío otra vez. You said you were gonna quit.
We both said things we didn't mean. Pero qué bueno que pasó todo esto para verte por fin. Feliz. Te envié una carta para tu cumpleaños, no sé si la recibiste. Digo, te he enviado una carta todos los años. No sé si cambiaste de dirección o algo. ¿Te mudaste?
Sí. Siempre la recibo.
Hay que aprovechar hasta cuando te queda.
I'm actually leaving tonight. Me voy a hacer ahorita. Perdón. Por no decirte que vine a Puerto Rico.
It's okay. It
was for work. They sent me down for work.
Cuéntame lo que hace.
It's not interesting.
Dale.
What do you want to know?
Lo que hace.
I'm a lawyer, okay? I'm the guy the companies call when you buy your shit, it breaks, and you get pissed off. I convince you you're wrong, and I make companies more money.
¿Para eso te pusiste viejo? Que te da placer. Come on, Mike. New York Mike. Big shot Mike.
Shade of a tree in El Monte. Cool breeze. Okay?
Para mí es flotar.
Weightless. Like breathing underwater. Cada sensor del cuerpo electrified. As if mind, body, and soul are elevated to its maximum potential.
Y para eso que tú me llamas. Para decirme las estupideces que te meten en problemas. When was your last meeting?
Son estupideces que tú sabes.
Are you even going to your meetings? You want to end up like mommy and papi? Oh, he'd be better off.
Suena justo. No te preocupes, Norita, que volvemos pronto.
I just live life to the fullest.
Don't.
Porque cuando te toca. Te toca.
Don't do this to yourself. For me, okay? I ask you again. Usa tu trust fund. Y busca
programa que te dije. O vete de Puerto Rico. You know, and get into a rehab clinic, you know, the one you like, whatever. It's a lot of money. It could be put to good use. You owe it to them, at least.
I know. Lo siento, hermano. It's not something you can just stop. I can't just stop. It's like stopping the sun from rising. No es así. Pero escúchame. I can't change lo de antes, pero I can be better. I can. Tengo todo el deseo de ser una buena persona. Yo soy una buena persona. Yo soy muy buena persona. Y tengo planes. Tengo muchos planes. Voy a conseguir un trabajo. Voy a comprarme una casa con huerto y todo eso. I promise. I'm gonna do it. Lo voy a hacer. I just need to skim the surface. That's all. No es nada. Confía en mí.
What are you talking about?
Just a little bit of help. Just a little bit of help. Just to skim the surface. And you know, you won't even know the difference, really. Para normalizar, ¿sabes? Me da lo que tú quieras, lo que...
Are you asking me for money?
Un préstamo.
For drugs?
No. O sea...
Espera. ¿Por qué tú me estás pidiendo dinero? ¿Y el tuyo?
Nora. Where's our parents' money?
I just...
What did you do with it?
Just a little help, Mia. Just a little help. Can you give me that?
Like we haven't given you enough.
Miguel,
yo no te voy a dar nada. You want help, you go to rehab.
¿De verdad no me vas a ayudar?
No. I'm not gonna help you kill yourself.
We all die. Everyone dies. No. Porque no me deja disfrutarme una existencia loca.
You do whatever the fuck you want without my fucking money that I earned with the sweat of my brow. I don't owe you shit.
I'm not saying that you owe me anything. I'm asking for your help, but it's mi hermano.
Hermoso.
Maestro.
Tú te hiciste esto.
Quisiera que me entendiera.
Oh, well, we all want things we can't have. I can't. I just can't.
Yo quiero trabajo.
Ahora. I'm gonna take care of them. You're safe.
This was the first place I worked when I moved to New York City as a young artist. One of the only places in New York where I can explore my artistic side and my culture. It's a place where both of those things can come together.
Also in the sense of community with front of house and just everybody involved in the Bregones family makes people feel happy and makes people leave the theater feeling lifted.
Welcome back to Bronx Film Wednesdays. Joining us now is writer-director Michelle Malley-Campos. Michelle is an NYU Tisch film grad with a concentration in writing and directing, with 15 years of production experience as a Directors Guild of America and non-union assistant director in over 24 features, TV shows, music videos, and commercials. Welcome, Michelle. Muchas gracias por estar con nosotros hoy.
Gracias por la invitación. Hello, everybody.
Of course. So we just saw your film, In Pieces, In Pedazos. What inspired you to write the story on the impacts of alcoholism and drug addiction in Puerto Rico?
Well, this story is, well, approximately from 2014. That's when I wrote it. And I think my main interest was to kind of step away from any moralization or anything in that kind of line of thinking, you know, kind of present a kind of a uncomfortable situation between these two characters who love each other. And I just kind of wanted to explore love through these difficult situations. And I think particularly in Puerto Rico, the topic of drug addiction is very present. I feel like every family, everyone has had some sort of situation with a loved one that falls into addiction. And I wanted to present it, you know, as drug addiction as and alcoholism can be both, you know, one and the same. So I think that's where that started. And actually the short comes from a feature that I had written that I was working on, you know, and the process of trying to put the film idea, the feature film idea out there was to make the short film first. So
thank you for that, Michelle. And in exploring that theme, you know, in such a hard-hitting topic such as alcoholism and drug addiction, you used a little bit of well-timed comedy to tackle this theme. Why was it important to include this comedic relief in your writing? And was it originally written comedically?
Well, I guess my style or how I like to write is to kind of always leave a little bit of space for comedy. I think that is what most comes close to real life, even in our darkest times or during tragic moments, maybe. At least, Boricuas, we try to, you know, lighten up the mood. I feel like always is always a particularity of how we deal with tragedy, with trauma, with everything. So I guess in the comedy aspect of the film, I was trying to reflect life as close as possible, and I think comedy is part of
it. It definitely came across, you know, naturally and wonderfully. It's just a conversation between two siblings, and, you know, you're almost kind of immersed into this uncomfortable situation with two siblings, but you feel welcomed almost in esa mesita, together with the siblings. So yeah. Nora and Miguel, they both have flashbacks of their childhoods within the film. Miguel appears to be stuck in the present time while Nora appears to be stuck in the past. Can you share more about this choice to show flashbacks and what it means for the character to go back in their past to help us understand their present?
Well, usually with alcoholism and or drug addiction, there's these underlying causes, right? And there are different reasons for why we go downward spirals or what have you. So I guess there's a difference in how each character is addressing their issues. Maybe the big brother is, you know, trying to kind of stay the course in a way and just kind of seguir para adelante, how we say, and just kind of not let the past be in his present, but in a way he's in this kind of state of denial, while Nora is more embracing her state of delusion, I guess, in a way, and the past kind of the flashback to the past kind of puts context to why he's in that space, you know, in that headspace. So I guess it's kind of trying to give context to how these two people got here and why maybe they think the way that they think.
Absolutely. And I think that seeing that in film helps us kind of like formulate that empathy. Right. A lot of times is lacked in, you know, judging people that have these addictions, whereas, you know, you wouldn't know, you know, why those transgressions are happening. So thank you for sharing that. So another thing I wanted to ask is that these protagonists have their parents' money. They have, they seem to be well-off and well-educated. They even speak English. With that being said, this film shows that these issues don't just affect the poor, right? Which is usually the stigma in right. this media.
Yeah, that's another stigma I kind of wanted to break, and I feel like it feels very present in our society, that type of stigma, and yeah, this is something that this topic, these issues, you know, do affect everybody, and no matter where they are socially or economically, and I kind of, you know, wanted to have that a little bit present, that, you know, despite kind of having everything in a way, having access to getting better, or, you know, there's still this downward spiral, and that can happen even when you have everything at your disposal, and that's how a lot of people, you know, lose the people that they love because of that alienation.
Right, absolutely. And I also found the ending to be an interesting cliffhanger. I'm sure a lot of other viewers are with me on this. Did it symbolize a new beginning for the siblings or the same endless cycle? What was your take on that when you directed that scene, the ending?
Is it like the idea was kind of to, you know, it could go one way or it could go the other. I am more of an optimist in that sense. I did present it in a very kind of open way, and so that we could talk about this, right? Like different people are going to take away different things, and what, you know, the feeling that that ending emotes is the idea. So we can all kind of like come together and talk about it, because every person is going to have a different feeling. And so I will, at least, you know, for me, I want to try to be optimistic in the sense that, yes, people can kind of reach out of the darkness, can help each other, you know, even when you think that it's no longer possible. So I think that in general, the idea is to, hey, we can help each other. We can all get through whatever we're going through together.
And like the note said, porque te quiero, because I love you. I thought that was so touching. You know, I pay attention to every little thing, and I appreciate every little direction that you took in creating this film. Thank you for sharing that as well. So ultimately, what do you hope that people take away the most from watching this film?
I think empathy a little bit, just, and also in the process of making this movie, and even, you know, with the crew members, everybody had a story about a brother or a friend, or, you know, we're all touched by this topic. And I think it's important to stay empathetic and to try to understand what people are going through. It's kind of hard maybe sometimes to open up to people about the issues we're going through. And we can kind of digress and choose poisons to help with the pain, thinking it's medicine. But I think that the idea is to present a story where, you know, there is hope, and we can, you know, lift each other up. We should try.
Thank you for that. Beautiful message. And I wanted to mention also, if the viewers think that Michelle looks familiar, she was playing Nora in the film. She's also one of the actors in the film. So writer, actor, and director of can you tell me a little bit about taking on that role as well, how that was for you?
Yeah, it was definitely a challenge on so many levels. I do like to challenge myself and see if, you know, I think I can do this. I'm going to give it a try. And acting has been always, you know, part of this concept of wanting to make movies. Ever since I was little, all I wanted to do was make movies. And for me, that included being in front of the camera in addition to, you know, writing and directing and producing it. So I think that it was also, you know, pretty long time ago. It was like, what, 6-7 years ago. And it was a challenge. It was a challenge. It requires a lot of concentration. But the idea was to kind of surround myself with colleagues that I trust, and entrust them in a little bit in sharing the burden a little of you know, I didn't want it to be just the way I wanted it to look. You know, I wanted the DP to look at me and say, that looked good. And also my AD, who are colleagues who have all this, you know, 20 to over 20 years of experience in the industry, and kind of entrust them with kind of like a thumbs up or, and okay, let's do it again. So I didn't have to constantly, you know, watch playback and just kind of, so that the production could flow. So, yeah, it was an interesting experience, and I'm not sure if I want to do it again or, you know, in a feature. You know, it is very demanding and difficult, but it was a very rewarding experience.
I love it. Well, three roles in one. She's a superwoman. Although you have a team behind you, and congrats to the team. Even though it was 7 years ago, it's an incredible film. And thank you for sharing the process and the inspiration behind it, as well as, you know, your experience doing these three real roles. Before we go, Michelle, please tell us about any current or future projects and how we can stay in touch with you and your work moving forward.
My Facebook is always full of whatever I'm doing. So Michelle Malley-Campos. Actually, I'm Michelle Tapioca Malley-Campos on Facebook. Watch out for news there. And also our company profile, Viento Films, is going to be doing a bunch of updates on there. And yeah.
Perfect. So we'll definitely stay in touch, and I'm sure all of our viewers will be in touch with you and following up with your work. Thank you so much, Michelle, for your time today.
Thank you so much for inviting me.
Claro. Te cuidas. That's the end of our show today. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez. Thank you for tuning in, and see you next time here at Bronx Film Wednesdays.